سمپوزیوم در واشنگتن، مذاکرات اتمی، مقابله با تهدید رژیم ایران، تعهدات دولت آمریکا و سازمان ملل متحد برای حفاظت و تضمین حقوق ساکنان اشرف و لیبرتی، 30 می 2012، 10 خرداد 1391. تمریج. ادوارد رندل، سفیر جان بولتون، فیلیپ جی کراولی، معاون و سخنگوی وزارت خارجه آمریکا 2009-2011، دستیار ویژه رئیس جمهور در امنیت ملی. پاتریک کندی، جودی چو، سرهنگ دیوید هانت، مشاور ارتش آمریکا در جنگ بوسنی، هماهنگ کننده ضد تروریسم. دیک موریس، مشاور کاخ سفید در ریاست جمهوری بیل کلینتون. پروفسور ایوان ساشا شیهان، رئیس بخش مذاکرات در دانشگاه بالتیمور، متخصص تروریسم و ضد تروریسم. تام تانکردو، سرهنگ وسلی مارتین، بروس مک‌کول،
Now our next speaker, U.S. Permanent Representative of the United Nations, is Under Secretary of State for Arms Control and International Security. Ambassador Bolton is currently a Foreign and National Security Policy Senior Fellow in the American Enterprise Institute, and his op-ed articles are regularly featured in New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Washington Times. John Bolton.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I wanted to touch briefly today on the situation with Iran's nuclear weapons program, because while we quite rightly focus on the plight of the people at Camp Ashraf and focus on their larger fate in getting refugee status and getting out of Iraq and developments in Iran broadly. I think with respect to the nuclear weapons program, we could be coming to a very, very critical point. And this has to do not with political or diplomatic hype or spin or speculation. It has to do with physics. And the physics have to do with the continued progress that the regime is making toward its long-sought objective of a deliverable nuclear weapons capability. Now, it's in connection with the regime's nuclear weapons program that I first learned of the MEK. I first saw the work that they were doing, exposing to the world information about this illicit activity by the regime that violated their commitments under the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, violated their agreements with the International Atomic Energy Agency, violated the comments they routinely made publicly that their only purpose in pursuing nuclear-related research was for civil power purposes. And as the evidence has accumulated over the years, what I saw that was classified when I was at the State Department often had a chance to compare to what the MEK was releasing publicly. And it was really remarkable. You know, people like myself and government can talk about the threat of nuclear proliferation. It sounds very abstract. When you think about it, it's been 50 years since we've had an atmospheric nuclear test. When I speak to college students and talk about the threat of nuclear proliferation, to them, a nuclear explosion, some grainy black and white TV footage from the late 40s or 50s, it's like a different world to them. Now, I'm not suggesting we resume atmospheric testing for educational purposes, don't get me wrong, but I'm saying that the reality of nuclear threats is something that's a little bit distant from people's experience. So to have information about the regime's activities made public, I felt was very important. And I think what we're seeing right now is that this 20-year-long effort by the regime is getting perilously close to success. We've had just in the past week yet another report by the International Atomic Energy Agency based on information that the IAEA has. It's essentially public information, not based on anything we don't know about, but based on what they see publicly. There's already a sufficient stock of low-enriched uranium for the regime to fashion into five or more nuclear devices with a little bit more work on the enrichment process. The production of enriched uranium, which anyone who knows anything about nuclear weapons will tell you is the long pole in the tent toward developing a weaponization capability, are proceeding essentially unhindered. New generations of centrifuges, much more efficient, with much greater capacity, prepared to be introduced. And this progress of building a broad and deep nuclear infrastructure continues. And in the meantime, while this work proceeds right in front of us, the United States, as it has for 20 years, is still trying to find ways to negotiate with this regime. This is a faith that goes beyond religious faith. You can't find empirical reality that justifies the continuation of this negotiation. There just simply isn't any evidence for it. Let's just look at the current round. With great fanfare, the five permanent members of the Security Council in Germany met with the regime's negotiators in Istanbul and had several days of negotiations. And when they finished, they came out and declared it was a great success. Much progress had been made. What was the tangible outcome? They had agreed to meet 5 weeks later in Baghdad. Well, that's pop the champagne. You know, diplomacy is the only profession on earth where success is defined as having another meeting. And where was that meeting? Baghdad, of all places. My goodness, isn't that an interesting selection? So we go to Baghdad and we hear reports that the IAEA is close to reaching agreement over access to the Parchin facility, an armor, artillery, missile base where the regime has undoubtedly been testing the high explosive component critical to weaponization, to taking the enriched uranium or plutonium in the pit of a nuclear weapon, compressing it into critical mass, and creating the uncontrolled chain reaction that the nuclear weapon is designed for. And negotiations at Baghdad then come after this happy news from the IAEA. Of course, there's no signed agreement. And yeah, there are still a few issues unresolved in Baghdad. And they have 2 days of negotiation. And what do they agree to? They agree to meet again. It's another success 4 weeks later in Moscow. Except this time we find by reports in the New York Times, and you know the New York Times is always right, but the New York Times reports that there was, this is their word, a frenzy of activity at the end because they couldn't agree on the next city. And they finally compromised on Moscow. You know, maybe the fourth meeting. Maybe the fourth meeting will be in Tehran. Why not? Let's cut to the chase here, you know? What is this doing? It is once again buying time for the regime to make progress toward nuclear weapons. Time is not a neutral factor in diplomatic negotiations. Those negotiations are like all other forms of human activity. They have costs as well as benefits. And the cost of negotiation is the time that Iran gets to continue to move toward that objective. People talk about the effect of sanctions as having a coercive impact on Iran. What effect? The Director of National Intelligence, the Obama administration's own appointee, testified to Congress 2 months ago that all of the existing sanctions had had no effect on Iran's behavior or policy in the nuclear field. And the new sanctions we see coming into effect this summer may have an economic impact, but there's simply no evidence they've done anything to slow down the Iranian nuclear weapons program. In fact, if anything, all of the attention to the sanctions, to Stuxnet and Flame, to other covert activities against the program simply divert us from the pressing reality that they are getting closer and closer to their objective. Without even knowing whether there are activities inside Iran, inside North Korea, inside Syria, we don't know about. Now, I think the answer here is that this has to be coupled by a declared policy of the United States government and our friends in Europe, that not only are we opposed to this regime having nuclear weapons, we are opposed to this regime, period, and it needs to be overthrown. Thank you very much.
Show the bipartisan nature of our support. You have to understand, I was at one time an appointee in the Reagan administration. We have had people here speaking who are people who came out of the Bush administration, someone I know that served in the Clinton administration. And now, Phil Crowley, who was nominated by President Obama as the United States Assistant Secretary of State for Public Affairs, served from 2009 to 11. Special Assistant to the President for National Security Affairs, Philip Crowley.
Thank you very much and good morning. For the past year as the Bradley Chair at the Penn State Dickinson School of Law, I've been staring at Tom Ridge's portrait, which sits outside the classroom where I have, as a non-lawyer, teaching lawyers about the national security environment of the 21st century. So it's a you know, your portrait's good. I every once in a while I have to tip it to make sure it's still in good shape. but I'm happy to be back with you again after hearing from Ed Rendell and Tom Ridge and John Bolton. I feel like I'm a support act. But just to make sure that there is a bipartisan tenure, when I'll divide my remarks into three sections. But to start off, I was here last year roughly about the same time, and I put my opening remarks in the context of what was then called the Arab Spring, now called the Arab Awakening, but obviously a dramatic dynamic and shift within the Middle East. Obviously, nobody could have predicted what has happened. And a year ago, I think we all had a greater degree of confidence because of the remarkable events that had occurred in Tunisia, Egypt, and were beginning to occur in Libya. Dramatic change that had occurred in days, weeks, and months. And I think we all had then and still do have confidence that no country is immune from the forces of change that have been unleashed in the region, and that includes the country of primary focus today being Iran. That said, I think we have a sober understanding that a year later, we do see another force at play, the force being one of resistance. And that has come not only through the armed intervention of Libya, which was successful, but obviously took longer than we had expected, because a leader, rather than bowing to the will of his people, decided to turn his weapons against his people. Now, Libya faces enormous challenges going forward, but at least now the people of Libya, and as we are seeing with the people of Tunisia and Egypt, have been empowered to choose for themselves who will govern their country and how. Now, we saw a leader in Yemen also resist. Eventually, he was forced to step down. Yemen's transition will be very different, much more incremental, but it will clearly take time and require significant international support. And as we all know, there is a genuine tragedy unfolding in Syria. We are shocked, unfortunately probably not surprised, by the lengths to which this brutal regime will go to cling to power at any cost. And just this weekend, as we know, the killing and execution of men, women, and children in the village of Hula. Now, as the State Department said yesterday, we see in this horrible act the impact of Iran, which actually bragged about the technical support it has provided to Syria to be able to resist the clear and compelling will of an ever-expanding segment of the Syrian people. And we also decry the fact that today Assad is able to hold on to power in large part because of the economic, political, and in the case of Russia, military support from countries like Russia and China and others that enable Bashar al-Assad to survive, at least for now. But I continue to believe a year later that it is still inevitable, as was said earlier, that real change will come, and real change will come to a country like Iran, where the people will have not only real politics, which actually, as you know, do exist in Iran, but a real choice as well, which does not happen today. Now, having left the State Department a year ago, we all have an aspiration for a better world, but we have to deal with the world in which we live today. We all want regime change in Iran, but we have to figure out how to get there, and we have to manage a process to where we open up new possibilities that may inevitably evolve. We don't want to live in a world, and people in the region don't want to live in the Middle East that has Iran possessing an actual nuclear weapon. Now, I'd like to tell you that Iran sits at a tipping point. The strength and the salience of the regime and its policies are in decline. Iran is feeling that pressure, but this is all the process of change is going to take some time to evolve. And that's what makes the challenge of Camp Ashraf so salient to all of us, to see the people of Ashraf, who represent a real alternative to the current regime in Iran, that they are able to leave Iraq safely. And ultimately, as much as we will do everything that we can from the United States, ultimately change in Iran, supported by all of us, will have to emerge first and foremost by forces inside Iran. It cannot be imposed from the outside. Now, we've heard compelling remarks by Governor Rendell and others about the challenging living conditions that we have. And we've talked about the need for deadlines, the needs for actions. Having been the one person having worked in the Obama administration, I will tell you, and perhaps John Bolton will agree with me, that within the State Department today, we have a dogged advocate, an Ambassador Dan Freed. He is one of our nation's distinguished diplomats. He can be a force of nature. And I trust Dan that he will work as hard as he can to move this process forward. Dan ultimately came back and kept on saying over and over again, the real key here is to not only move people from Ashraf to liberty, but the real key is moving them out of Iraq to a safer place. And that is where the process, while it does exist, and that is a source of progress, this process has to be better. And this process has to move faster. We do not literally have any time to waste. Barely 20% of the residents of Camp Ashraf that have moved have been interviewed by the UN. This has to get faster and better. And I would say the real deadline that we should continue to press for the United States as a leader in this process is to ask the question over and over again, when will the first refugee leave Camp Ashraf, and when will the first refugee arrive here in the United States? We can more effectively go to other countries in the world. As Governor Ridge said, where's the rest of the world in this? We are in a much stronger position when we have already opened our door, welcomed the first residents of Camp Ashraf to the United States, and then say to the rest of the world, we are doing our share. Now it's your turn. That's the day I want to see happen, and that's the key metric as we work on all of the other things, the air conditioners working, and so on and so forth. Ultimately, to have this be a credible, successful process, it can't just be moving from Ashraf to liberty. It's got to be moving from liberty to somewhere safer and better. Thank you very much.